God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the source of all mercy and the God of all consolation, he comforts us in all our sorrows so that we can comfort others in their sorrows with the consolation we ourselves have received from God. When we were buried in Christ Jesus, we were baptized into his death. We were buried, therefore, with him by baptism into death, so that as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, we too might live a new life. For if we've been united with him in a death like this, we shall certainly be united with him in a resurrection like his. Let's all stand for our opening hymn, Amazing Grace, which Mark is going to explain to you.
Good morning. This song, Amazing Grace, I know everybody knows this song, but it's not the traditional version of it. This song is done to the tune of House of the Rising Sun. And so the first verse I will do, because you don't have it, and it's a different verse. So we'll do this first verse, and then the second, third, the next four verses, you'll come in on them. So, thank you.
Us who mourn. Give us your aid so we may see in death the gate to eternal life, that we may continue our course on earth in confidence until by your call we are reunited with those who have gone before us through your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated. At this time,
David Sparkman is going to come and read the obituary for us. David, let me get this here. Do you have a copy of it? Okay.
Beloved grandchildren, he was loved and missed by many brothers-in-law, sister-in-law, nieces, nephews, Mark and I spent a lot of time together over the last few years. I would take him occasionally to his pain or wound clinic, and we had a lot of time to talk. I go, he lived right across the street, so I go, and we'd have our good chats. He became quite brief in the end because he didn't have much energy. We joked around a lot, you know. When I was, when he got tired and I would be angry, I would, you know, he would say, "Goodbye, Dave, nobody loves you." Well, I guess I'll wrap it up here by saying, Mark, nobody loves you. Except you. Thank you. All of us.
I want to say amen to what David just said. Every time I went and visited Kim and Mark, I was just touched by the love I saw, not just Kim for Mark, but Mark for Kim. And I never saw Kim get upset with Mark. I never saw Mark demand of Kim. I'm sure there were moments, but not in front of the pastor. No, it's just real. And I want to thank you, Kim, for being an example, and Mark, of selfless, unconditional. That I need in my marriage as well, and we all need in all of our marriages and relationships. Thank you. At this time, other family members, I believe, are going to say a few things. Is there anybody else that wants to come up? All right.
Always tried to do whatever he could for me, and It was my 16th birthday. And I had to go to school like every other kid did. Should have gone to school. we'll get to that one in a minute. So if most of you knew me as a teenager, I wasn't so hip about waking up at 6 or 7. School started at 7. I still didn't want to wake up. But Mark comes up to my room, and we lived in a house in Ogden. And he had to go upstairs, knocks on my door, and says, "You want to go get your driver's license today?" Yeah. "School or driver's license? That's a hard choice." I went, "Yeah." He's like, "Okay, I'll take you." I'm like, "Well, is mom going?" "Oh, no, she went to work." "Oh, okay." So he's like, "Go back to sleep. We'll wake up in a little bit and go." "What about school?" He goes, "School or driver's license?" Fair enough. Let's go. A couple hours later, I wake up, I go downstairs. "You ready to go?" And he's like, "Sure. However, we need breakfast first." "Oh, yes, we need breakfast." So he hands me the keys, goes, "You're driving." I'm like, "I don't have my license yet." He's like, "Okay." Let's go. So we went, had breakfast, go up to the DMV. He signs all the paperwork. I get my license. Years later, I find out, well, Utah shouldn't have let me do that, being a step-parent at the time. So my license was technically invalid for a couple years. And he was nice enough to point that out to me after we were watching something on TV. I'm like, "Oh, great." He's like, "You helped me break the law. Great." This is the kind of step-parent I had. Seriously. No, he always was there to do anything I ever asked. If I needed something, God. Every time your kids were born, he'd come to the hospital and he'd bring a cigar with him. "You have to have one," he said. "They're born, you have to have one." I'm like, "I don't think the hospital's gonna let me." He's like, "You gonna ask?" "Okay." He always had this great way of going, "Well, we'll just do it and ask for forgiveness later." And it was great. We left, you know, Mom keeps reminding me of the day of their marriage. They got married here almost 30 years ago. We left them at home. it wasn't my fault. It was, I think, either Tim or Tom's fault. One of the two. They were driving. I was not old enough at the time. And we get here at the church, and Mom's like, "Where's Mark?" I'm like, "Not here. We need to go get him." "Okay." So, I mean, we always had a great adventure. It was a great, great time. You know, he always, every time I called, even in the later part, I had to talk to him the day before on Father's Day, and you could tell he was tired, just tired. But he still wanted to talk. He just wanted to see how I was doing. Talk about nothing. We always had conversations about nothing. And I know many of you can relate. We call it, you know, talking. It's just the subject changes, and you're like, "Oh, okay." But he wanted to talk. And he always would say, "Love you, son," after we got off, before he got off the phone. And, you know, it's just weird going to Mom's house and just not seeing him there. I know he's in a better place. He's not hurting. So, we all have our great memories, and have a couple of mine. So, thank you.
Johns, and for those who might not know me, and I am Mark's older sister. His younger sister is back there with me, came from Oregon to be here today, and so I thought maybe I'd just take a minute and in his obituary, it talks about the sneak up birds. And I thought maybe I would let you know where that came from, the story behind it. We lived in Southern California at the time, and there were, Stephen had been born there, so there were there was David, myself, Daniel, Mark, and then the youngest at the time was Stephen. More to come when we moved to Utah, but at that time. And one of the things about where we lived down by San Diego, and there were roadrunner birds. And if you know any, if you've ever been around roadrunner birds, they really do run on the road. I mean, they also fly, but they're quite aggressive on the road, on the ground. And they're not very big birds. They're kind of smallish, but they're pretty aggressive for their size. Well, we have many run-ins as kids with the roadrunners, and we had a favorite game we liked to play at the time, which was to take Stephen, who couldn't walk yet, who was about less than a year old, and we would put him in the driveway of our house, and then the rest of us, all four of us, would run back in and stand at the big window in the front of the house so we could watch what was going to happen. And sure enough, not long before, there would be three or four roadrunners who would start running up to Stephen, the baby, and then he would scream, and they would come from behind and on the sides. They just kind of basically got all around him. And of course, as kids, we thought that was just hilariously funny, when it really wasn't that funny, but we thought it was. So we used to call those roadrunners, because they would come at you from behind, we would call them sneak up birds. And so when we thought about it, we realized that was really kind of a cruel thing for us to do to Stephen. And it wasn't really all that funny. But ever since then, if somebody did something that was particularly vicious or nasty or cruel, we would call it a sneak up bird thing. So all of us in the family who had been around at that time knew what it was that had been done. It was a sneak up bird thing, and it was probably pretty nasty. That's where that came from. And we had quite a few adventures in California, and then we moved to, most of us, including Mark, had been born in Texas, and then we moved to California, where my dad was working in the aerospace kind of area. He worked on rockets and designed pneumatic and hydraulic parts for rocket ships. And then he came to Utah to work for what would eventually become Morton Blackall. And so we came here, and by then, we had Stephen, and then we got here, my mom initially had Deb, and then James, and then the twins, Timothy and Thomas. So we were a relatively large family, with a lot of kids in the family, and a lot of personalities, of course. And I will just say, along with Dave, that Mark was one of the peacekeepers in the family. He was sort of like the ideal middle child, and he really did a lot of this, taking care of people's feelings, people's, being upset, et cetera. I don't want to suggest that Mark didn't have his toxic elements to him, but of course he did. And a lot of that had to do with his addictions. But I want to say, in the essence of who he was really a kind and sweet and loving person. He could be demanding, and he could be confrontive, of course, especially from that point of view, which was mostly all the time. Tim was his angel, his absolute guardian angel in every way. Only she really worked hard at it, I'm not going to do it. But I know Kim did. And I agree with David that Mark would not have lived as long as he did had it not been for her kind and generous and constant care that she gave to Mark. She is a true angel in my book. And I really, really have appreciated her more than I can say. And I know that the love between the two was enormous. And they were acquainted in high school, where they met out in high school, and then Mark went on to have a few adventures. And before he got back with Kim, but we're so glad that they were able to do that, and that they were able to get back together after being separate for a while, and that could be this really great couple that they were. You know, I think when I look back on Mark's life, the things that he would tell me about what he was most proud of, I can remember distinctly when he got that scholarship from the English department to finish up his degree, which unfortunately he wasn't able to do, but he was so proud of the fact that he was able to garner that scholarship. And I went to the ceremony to see him, you know, they kind of had a little ceremony with it, and I don't know if I've ever seen him happier than he was that day. He was just beaming. And to be recognized by the English department faculty, who really loved him. And there were many people at Weber State who really thought highly of Mark. In fact, I just talked to one of my colleagues a couple of weeks ago, and she said that she had Mark in a couple of her classes, and that he was one of the most incredible students that she has ever taught. He had an incredible intellect. He was such a creative person, and ultimately knew the theories and the practice of writing and being in the moment of the writing so well. She was just thrilled to have him and was very sad to hear of his passing. The English department faculty who had been there when Mark was there often ask me, as I see them in the building, the humanities building, how Mark is. They remember him far longer than many other students because he was truly an incredible student, an incredible human being in many ways. I also remember, if I could, just saying that I think one of the most proud times he had in his life was when he and Kim were able to take her grandchildren in for a while things were sorted out in the home life there. He really enjoyed that, but he also took great pride in the fact that he could open up his home to these children and make a good, stable home for them. And to be able to do that, he was justifiably so happy and proud that they were able to do that during that time. It was one of the highlights of his life, I think, for sure. You know, he had many highlights, and I'm sure many lowlights, but in many ways, it was the people he surrounded himself with, the relationships he built with people that were the core of who he was. And, you know, I wish that more people could have understood and been a part of his loving relational being, because he really was that way. He didn't judge, as David said, he didn't judge people, but he took them as they were and really listened to what you had to say, which is a great, great quality in a person. People don't listen too much anymore. And he was very good at drawing people into him. He often told great stories, of course, which were mostly about him, but he was also good at drawing people in to his circle and making them feel special. And I have a feeling that as Mark looks down on us today, and I truly believe that his existence is ongoing somewhere, and that his personality, his knowledge, his abilities have gone with him, and that one day we will be able to be with him again. And this kind of reassurances are what gets me through a difficult time of separation and loss with the people who run in our lives. And I have a feeling that he feels like he's just, you know, as he told me once before, he's just kind of going along the path here. He's just a little bit farther along the path than we are. But pretty soon we're going to catch up to him, and he's kind of waiting for us. And he'll be there to be with us as we walk the end of the path. And I think, you know, if we could hear him now, he would say, hold your closest to you, those people you love. Tell them often that you love them. And no worries, because I'll be here for you when you come down the path. And that I love you, and I will always remember our times together. And as I think of him going down the path, I just kind of waving over his shoulder, take care, everybody. We'll see each other again. And we will be reunited in our love for each other and our love for Jesus Christ and for his incredible power to redeem us, to save us. And I am so thankful that Mark was able to live the life that he did. It could have been so much worse, and yet he had an incredible intellect, an incredible spirit. And I am so proud of him as a sister that he touched so many lives in his time on this earth. And I know that he loves each and every one of you so much, and that he hopes for the best for you. So we'll see him on down the path. All of us will be there. And we'll see him and reunite with him again. And I say these things in the name of Jesus Christ, and our Redeemer. In the name of Jesus Christ, amen. Amen.
Started learning stuff, it was the way my dad learned it. That was wrong. Yes, I'm gonna throw you under the bus because it's fun. But you told me to open. You taught me how to open my eyes to certain subjects and see other see views in different ways. There's a lot of different ways. But for the fondest things I remember about him is when me and him was finally took interests. He learned guitar. I learned chess. It's probably the worst thing to do because if I didn't know something, granted, do it on me. And then he literally got, which letter? I'm like, this. He's like, did it work? Like, for you, yeah, not me. And another thing, the first thing I remember was when we were little, coming to church on a Sunday, we'd always do this thing. We'd go buy a donut, have a donut parade, which so mad we didn't get to do it again before we did it. I really was looking to do it one more time because it. Every time we did it, made him smile, made him happy. He actually got out of bed and hugged us, which is awesome. So I'm just scattering right now. I don't usually talk to other people. But another thing I've learned, I've seen a lot of stuff that I didn't know about my grandfather in the past 48 hours of being back in Utah. I saw what he looked like when he was in high school. I saw what he looked like when I was born, which was kind of, I think it's kind of cool because it's the first photo I have of him. With me and him. I saw what he looked like when it was said when we were being raised by my granddad. It showed a lot of perspective of the man. He literally just accepted his two stepchildren, he accepted his grandchildren, and he went even more hard. And yes, that dude took him yes, that dude was stubborn, yes, that dude was, pardon my word, he was kind of annoying sometimes, because if you didn't know it, he'd tell you, show it, and then you know it, and then get you for not knowing it. But he always, no matter what her issue was, he would always just sit down and listen to this. I remember a long time when at my granddad day, and I hit something by accident, and I broke it, and he didn't really mind. It was an accident. I thought I'd get in trouble like crazy because then it would have killed me. Well, she did later, but that's a different issue. Well, no, he didn't care what she did. He didn't care what fault she had. He knew he had good intentions, just bad actions. And that left a mark on me. I understand you have good intentions, but I will always teach you bad action because it's the best thing you can ever do. It's a fun thing you can ever do. Well, for me it is. And my siblings will attest. I know you can write, but I still teach you for the best. Fun. Sorry, like I said, I'm not really part of staying for crowds because I'm going from crowd work, you know. Standing back to work and that's what else takes credit. But I have a lot of memories of him. A lot of them are of him just saying, hey, this looks stupid, stop. I learned. I was young. I learned from him. I had to. So when I came back, when we flew back, I met Nana here. And I saw some photos, and it brought up something that hadn't crossed my mind. And the last time I spoke to him, we were in my porch. Well, we were in our backyard, and we were video chatting him on, what was it? I don't know. It was Apple something. It was on his tablet. We were video chatting him on his tablet, and Granite brought up D&D. And if you know me, and if you get to know me, I'm a huge D&D fan. I would be guilty. I've got a whole bag full of dice. But he brought up something that he wanted to play a game, and I was told before that it was D&D, it was family. All he tried to do was get dice, and now that he's gone, I'm gonna really miss that game. Because that would have been like the highlight of my school. playing D&D. I played D&D with my dad. I played D&D with my brother. I didn't get a chance to play with my granddad. And that was probably the thing that was the most. But it had been a stick. I know people there, but it had been fun. But that's the whole point of it. Just get lost in the fantasy. And I know, like people said, he was an avid driver, so getting lost in fantasy was a game. That was his everything he could do. I remember sitting down and talking to him about some of his actually short stories he wrote, because when I was younger, I was like, I like writing. And again, I still don't have hammer and cord, but that's what he computers for now. But I remember sitting down, I would get lost in fantasy the story of the town. And then when he told me he wrote music, and I was like, oh, I'm not really good at that, but I'll enjoy that because it's nice. And now that it's gone, all I have are memories and a dice game that I really want to play. I guess I'm not able to speak more, but let's do the work and then someone else do the rest. Just check on my company, okay? I know. I had a memory in my head and then I lost it because honestly, coming out talking to everyone, I didn't care about it. I didn't care about it. I'm done. Again, I did as much as I could. Smack.
We all came to see him, or we video chatted or anything. Whatever he was doing, it was a pause or it was a break because he wanted to know about us. And we would ask him how he was doing or how he was feeling, and he always pushed his feelings and stuff aside to see how everybody else was doing and how they were going. And I remember getting a phone call from my dad, and I was at work doing a night shift at work. I think it was like 3 o'clock in the morning to let me know that he passed away. And my nurse looked at me and told me I should go home. And I looked at my nurse and told her, no. So I went home. My grandpa would tell me to stay there and finish what I wanted to do in life because he always made sure that we had everything on first. And as many times I video chatted them, called them, it was his grandkids or his kids first, so family first. Every time I tried to ask, it was never Target down here and we pick up his favorite donut, Boston King filling, right? donut, yep. And every Sunday, each kid, we had this donut on a napkin, and we all take it to his room, and each kid had a napkin, and one kid had the donut with the napkin, and it rotated. Every kid had the donut every week, every Sunday. And his smile on his face every time he came in that room was so bright. And then we end up, we all get older, and it wasn't really our thing when we got older, but we still did it. And then it started where one day of the week in the summer, each kid would take a turn and spend the whole day with Nana. And it was more Brandon because Hannah was at work. So he'd pick us up from Dad's house, and we'd go down to the little gas station down the road, and we'd pick out our favorite candy. And he always told us to pick the bags of candy because it had more and it was cheaper. So we'd pick those, and we'd go out of the house, and we'd go swimming first, and then each friend could have their own thing. He was teaching me guitar and painting, and it was all fun, and then we'd all go back home. And I think that's something I miss more. But, you know, you always remember that wherever he is, we're first on his list.
Thank you so much. Not easy to come up and do this, so deeply appreciate you sharing your experiences.
Can I say a short word?
You can?
Yes.
Thank you.
Sure.
Family members have stated about Mark and his love, and I'm one of the band members here. We go back, it's junior high. I'm not going to go ahead. But I think we were in a different band. I don't think we got in a band together until after high school. Musicians, the best thing for them is it's like almost like a young woman or a young man that married an Asian. They want to find somebody that's better than them, you know, out of the league. And Mark was way out of my league. But a few years ago, well, it's probably been 10 years ago. We were playing one together, and he says, I said, Mark, you're so wonderful. He said, I wish I could do this. And that was very surprising. But yeah, he was a very, very loving, caring, intelligent person, and he'll always live in my heart. I don't think I know all the 95 children, but the ones I've met and heard speak.
Thank you. Thank you for that good word as well. There's no one else. Mark Morris is going to sing. Love.
Running over Grandpa Road back in 1923. Grandpa kept it in his coat and he showed it once to me. Boy, you might not understand, but I long, long time ago. Grandma's daddy didn't like me none, but I loved your grandma so. We had this crazy plan to meet, run away together, married in the first town we came to and live forever. Nailed to a tree where we were supposed to meet instead. I found this letter. This is what it said. If you get there before I do, don't give up on me. I'll meet you when my chores are through. I don't know how long I'll be, but I'm not gonna let you down. Darling, wait and see. And between now and then, till I see you again, I'll be loving you. Love me. Read those words just hours before my grandma passed away. Doorway of a church where me and grandpa stopped to pray. No one never seen him cry in all my 15 years. But as he said these words to her, his eyes filled up with tears. If you get there before I do, don't give up on me. I'll meet you when my chores are through. I don't know how long I'll be, but I'm not gonna let you down. Darling, wait and see. And between now and then, till I see you again, I'll be loving you. Love me. And between now and then, till I see you again, I'll be loving you. Love me.
Thank you all. The scriptures that have been chosen today, Kim, these are very, very significant scriptures. Got you through the hard times. I don't know if you quoted them back and forth to each other, but read them to each other.
Said, these are the scriptures I want because they got us through. And so, and they're great scriptures, and the last one is what I'll preach from, 2 Corinthians 12, 7 through 10. Kim has selected for us today Isaiah 41, 10, Joshua 1, 9, Psalm 121, verses 1 and 2, Psalm 59, 16. So hear the word of the Lord, Isaiah 41, 10. So do not fear, for I am with you. Do not be dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you and help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand. Joshua 1, 9. Have I not commanded you? Be strong and courageous. Do not be afraid. Do not be discouraged, for the Lord your God will be with you wherever you go. Psalm 121, 1 and 2, which right here we have the mountains. So the psalmist said, I lift up my eyes to the mountains. Where does my help come from? My help comes from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. And Psalm 59, 16, but I will sing of your strength in the morning. I will sing of your love, for you are my fortress, my refuge in times of trouble. In 2 Corinthians 12, verses 7 through 10, by the Apostle Paul, therefore, in order to keep me from becoming conceited, I was giving a thorn in my flesh, a messenger of Satan to torment me. Three times I pleaded with the Lord to take it away from me, but he said to me, my grace is sufficient for you. for my power is made perfect in weakness. Therefore, I will boast all the more gladly about my weaknesses so that Christ's power may rest on me. That is why, for Christ's sake, I delight in weaknesses, in insults, in hardships, in persecutions, in difficulties. For when I am weak, then I am strong. The word of the Lord. We cannot escape the fact that life involves the extremes of joy and sadness, laughter and tears, pleasure and suffering. As we gather in this place today, one side of the scale remains most prevalent. Momentarily, the joy is covered up by the sadness. Tears have washed away the laughter, and the gathering seems to conclude a long journey of suffering. One of the challenges of this moment is to realize that joy, laughter, and pleasure have not been permanently destroyed. In God's grace, they will return. As the writer of Revelation has written, God will wipe away every tear from their eyes. There shall be no more death. The journey of suffering is not an easy one. This good friend, brother, husband, grandfather, whom we come today to remember, knew well this experience. Mark could empathize with Paul, who spoke freely about his own suffering. In the 11th chapter of 2 Corinthians, Paul listed the five times he received 40 stripes minus one from his detractors, and occasions when he was beaten three times with rods, stoned once, and shipwrecked three times. However, the worst of Paul's suffering came from his thorn in the flesh. We do not know what his thorn was, and it really doesn't matter. We only know that it caused him great suffering and pain. Scripture indicates that he pleaded three times with the Lord to remove the source of suffering. This aspect of life was not a game to Paul, but a very serious matter. The response of God to Paul's pleas has become a source of hope for all who have spent endless hours in the night with pain. The response of God to be, "My grace is sufficient for you." But our first impression might be that God is not. Yet even our own experience teaches that God addressed the problem with the only true solution. Paul understood his circumstances as a way of making him open to Christ's strength. He knew firsthand the meaning of dependency upon God, and his experience of suffering became an asset to his faith rather than a liability. For us today, though, there's a question deep within us. Why did God not heal Paul? Why did God not heal Mark? There certainly was no shortage of prayers offered up for him. These are questions that for the present must remain unanswered, as none of us can speak for God. Yet there is one claim that we can made from all, with all certainty, and it is that God takes no pleasure in the suffering of any of his children. God is no sadist who enjoys making others suffer. The God we worship cries with us in our pain, as the psalmist tells us this morning, God is close to the brokenhearted. In all circumstances in life, he is at work for good. As does any earthly father, God wants the best for his children. So we ask, then why doesn't God bring healing immediately? We simply don't have those answers. We do know, as the prophet Isaiah tells us, God's ways are not our ways. And his thoughts are not our thoughts. But we also know that nothing can separate believers, as Mark was, from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus. It appears that the strength of Paul's character came from weathering many storms. His suffering became the source of spiritual strength. I cannot not help but think of this aspect of Paul's life when I think of Mark, whom we honor and celebrate today. There was a thorn in Mark's flesh. But it seemed as though Mark and Kim understood, as Paul said in Philippians 1:29, for it has been granted unto you for the sake of Christ not only to believe in him, but also suffer for his sake. I say that because in the times that I visited Mark and Kim, I never once heard either of them complain about anything. What a privilege it was to visit them and take communion to them, as many of our congregants did as well. Both of them encouraged me in my faith journey more than you will ever know. On the surface, it would appear that Mark's struggle ended as a loss. But may I remind you that eye has not seen, ear has not heard, mind has not conceived of the things that God has prepared for those who love him. And Mark loved the Lord. Mark believed that Jesus died for him and loved God for that gift of salvation that he received by grace through faith alone in Christ. Mark's suffering was the result of Adam's sin in the garden. So now we live in a fallen world where sickness, disease, disability, and death exist. But one day, when Jesus returns, all things will be made new. Until he returns, we have no choice but to trust him and go forward with our lives. As family and friends today, this event makes us realize we're not immune from suffering either. We know in the moment the pain that life can offer, so what do we need in our time of need? We need a sense of security, warmth, and assurance. And there's a source available for that. God's strength is sufficient to meet all our needs here this morning. Consider the image of comfort offered in Isaiah 40, verses 10 and 11. The image is a very warm picture of God's love that embraces. Isaiah says, he will feed. God will gather. He will carry them in his bosom. He will do all this not only in the good times, but also in the difficult days as well. For Paul and Isaiah, God came in strength in moments of weakness, and he will do the same for us today. Isaiah went on to say that all of this is not in vain. God does not come to those who wait. God does come to those who wait. Mark did a full share of waiting, and so have you, but particularly Kim. At the point of what seems to feel like failing strength, God gives power to the faint. Because of God's presence and power, we will all once again soar like eagles, run and not be weary, walk and not be faint. For Mark, that change has already occurred, as Paul tells us in 2 Corinthians 5. And we know that as long as we are alive here on earth, we are absent from the Lord, for we live by faith, not by sight. Thus we are full of courage and would prefer to be away from the body and at home with the Lord. Mark is absent from his body now and present with the Lord. He is no longer suffering, going in and out of the hospital and dealing with illness every day. He is with Jesus, as Mark's faith was in him alone for his salvation. Now he is only experiencing eternal light and love. He is safely home with his Savior. Perhaps he would want us to hear this poem as though it was his to us this morning. It's entitled Safely Home. I am home in heaven, dear ones, oh so happy and so bright. There is perfect joy and beauty in this everlasting light. All the pain and grief is over, every restless tossing past. I am now at peace forever, safely home in heaven. Did you wonder I so calmly trod the valley of the shade? Oh, but Jesus' love illumined every dark and fearful glade. And he came himself to meet me in that way so hard to tread, and with Jesus' arm to lean on, could I have one doubt? You must not grieve so sorely, for you dearly still try to look beyond life's shadows, pray to trust our Father's will. There is work still waiting for you, so you must not idly stand. Do it now while life remains, or shall rest in Jesus' land. When that work is all completed, he will gently call you home. Oh, the rapture of that meeting. Oh, the joy to see you come. Amen and amen.
I'm trying hard not to think you unkind, but Heavenly Father, if you know my heart, surely you can read my mind. Good people underneath the sea of grief, some get up and walk away, some will find ultimate relief. Home free, effectual. the ultimate heathen, we will be home free. Home free. Oh, I've got a feeling that the ultimate heathen, we will be home free. Out in the corridors, we pray for life. Mother for her baby, a husband for his wife. Sometimes a good die young, it's sad but true. While we pray for one more heartbeat, real comfort is with you. No pain has little mercy, and suffering no respecter of age, of race or position. I know every prayer gets answered, but the hardest one to pray is slow to come. Oh Lord, not mine, but your will be done. Oh, let it be home free, eventually, at the ultimate healing, we will be home free. Home free. Oh, I got a feeling, at the ultimate healing, we will be home free. Home free. Eventually, at the ultimate healing, we will be home free. Home free. Oh, I've got a feeling, at the ultimate healing, we will be home free. Home free.
Let's all stand and affirm our faith together by saying the Apostles' Creed. Lutherans are creedal people, so always have to creed. God has made us his people through our baptism into Christ, living together in trust and hope. We confess our faith. I believe in God,
Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Thank you. May be seated. This time will be a number of prayers and the responses. Hear us, Lord. We'll finish that up with the Lord's Prayer using trespasses. Let us pray. Almighty God, you knit your chosen people together in one communion. In the mystical body of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, give your whole church in heaven and on earth your light and your peace. Hear us, Lord. Grant that all who have been baptized in Christ's death and resurrection may die of sin and rise to newness of life, and that through the grave and gate of death we may pass with him to our joyful resurrection. Hear us, Lord. Grant to us who are still in our pilgrimage and who walk as yet by faith that your Holy Spirit may lead us in holiness and righteousness all our days. Hear us, Lord. Grant in your faithful people pardon and peace, that we may be cleansed from all our sins and serve you with a quiet mind. Hear us, Lord. Grant to all who mourn us your confidence and your loving care, that casting all their sorrow on you, they may know the consolation of your love. Hear us, Lord. Give courage and faith to those who are bereaved, that they may have strength to meet the days ahead in the comfort of a holy and certain hope, and in the joyful expectation of eternal life with those they love. Hear us, Lord. Help us, we pray, in the midst of things we cannot understand, to believe and trust in the communion of saints the forgiveness of sins, and the resurrection to life everlasting.
Hear us, Lord.
Grant us grace to entrust Mark to your never-failing love, which has saved him in this life. Receive him into the arms of your mercy, and remember him according to the favor you bear for your people. Hear us,
Lord.
God of all grace, you sent your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, to bring life and immortality to light. We give you thanks, because by his death, Jesus destroyed the power of death, and by his resurrection has opened the kingdom of heaven to all believers. Make us certain that because he lives, we shall live also, and that neither death nor life, nor things present nor things to come, shall be able to separate us from your love, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Let us say the Lord's Prayer together. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever.
Amen. In your hands, O merciful Savior, we commend your servant, Mark Morris Sparkman. Acknowledge, we humbly beseech you, a sheep of your own fold, a lamb of your own flock, a sinner of your own redeeming. Receive him into the arms of your mercy, into the blessed rest of everlasting peace, and in the glorious company of the saints in light. Amen. Let us go forth in peace, in the name of Christ. Amen. Let's all stand for the closing hymn. On eagle's wings. The family will be in the back to meet, greet you, share with you, and then after that, there's a meal over in the fellowship hall. All are invited. We pray and trust that you really felt uplifted today, celebrating Mark's life.
Friends and family who couldn't be here. So thank you, Kim. We love you, Kim.